Welcome to lecture series on part 2 of module 3, kinematic synthesis or design of mechanisms. In the previous part, that is part 1 of module 3, we discussed about velocity and acceleration analysis using the analytical method by complex algebra approach. So we will go to a different part of kinematics called as kinematic synthesis. So first we will try to establish the relationship between kinematic synthesis as well as the kinematic analysis. So when we see here, the study of motions of machines can be considered from two different perspectives. One can be classified as kinematic analysis and another can be classified as kinematic synthesis. Our main objective in the kinematic analysis was to find out displacement, velocity and acceleration characteristics. So based on that, I could find out what are the dynamic forces or stresses that are acting on the system and corresponding actions can be taken. So that is the overall approach for the kinematic analysis. But when we switch over to kinematic synthesis, it is a completely reverse approach. We are supposed to design a mechanism. In analysis, a designed mechanism is given to you with all corresponding parameters, such as type of the mechanism, its length is given, everything is given to you. You just have to analyze it. Mechanism is already going to exist for the analysis, but for the synthesis, you have to create a brand new mechanism which should meet certain motion specification according to the machine that you are going to design or a mechanism that you wish to design based on your idea or customer requirement whatsoever. So therefore, kinematic synthesis is a reverse problem, which means that mechanism will not be available to you, but you are supposed to design a mechanism based on the constraints or based on certain parameters that they would throw to you, right? So now let me take a small example of a cam follower and a gear train. So now to design a cam, to give a follower the given displacement. So let me see, this is a cam that I have here. This is a cam. This is a cam and this is the follower. So now if the cam has to give something to follower, if the cam has to give a displacement to the follower, right? So then what should be the geometry of the cam or what should be the geometry of the follower? So that is what I am supposed to determine here. So that will be the approach in the kinematic synthesis. So similarly, we have something called as gear trains, combination of gears. The probable example that you would have gone through is the gearboxes, right? So here my objective will be to find out, right? So to find out the desired velocity ratio. So if red is the input and green is the output, so what should be the number of teeth on each gear so that I am going to obtain a proper velocity ratio, right, which is required to drive the mechanisms. That is the overall objective of the kinematic synthesis approach, right? So various type of mechanisms can be used, such as it can be a linkage, which is a lower pair mechanism. It can be a cam, which is a higher pair that you just saw in the last slide. It can be rolling surfaces, including gears, anything. So anything can be given as an input. So now it becomes important for a designer to be familiar with different kinds of kinematic synthesis before we proceed with the topics that are assigned to us, right? So thus, in a design of mechanism for an application, first a decision must be reached regarding the type of mechanism that needs to be employed. So I am given with a problem statement. A customer comes to me and tells me certain parameters or tells me some ideas, or I have some ideas on my own. So what is the type of mechanism that I am supposed to use? Should I use a lower pair mechanism? Should I use a higher pair mechanism? Should I use a four bar, slider crank, cam, gear trains? There are so many mechanisms available. Which one should I employ? That is the first step in the kinematic synthesis, right? Deciding between a cam, gear or linkage whatsoever. The number of links and the connections required to give the desired degrees of freedom must then be defined. So then I should find out the number of links and the connections that are required. So that becomes the second part. So that is called I should be able to find out the degrees of freedom of the mechanism based on my wish. So finally, I should be able to find out the required dimensions, right, to bring or to produce the desired particular motion. So that would be the objective. So you can identify three steps here. One is I should be able to find the type of mechanism. I should be able to choose rather than find, I should be able to choose a proper type of mechanism. We should be able to find out the number of links that are required and the connections that are required. And the third one is, I should be able to find out the required dimensions. So these are the three different classifications of the kinematic synthesis. So the first one is simply called as a type synthesis problem, wherein I am just going to choose the different choose a mechanism from different mechanisms available in the library. In the number synthesis, my objective will be to find number of links for a given mechanism. So let me see, I am going to design a cam. So how, what should, or let me say I am going to design a gear train. So how many gears should be employed, how many number of gears should be employed? That's a number synthesis problem. In the dimensions, what are the dimensions required? What should be the diameter, etc.? All those things you are going to find out. So these are known as kind of synthesis. So now, to go ahead, we can broadly classify the kinematic synthesis into three problems. One is the type synthesis, wherein you are going to choose a kind of mechanism, right? Like a cam, gear, whichever that suits the idea. Then you are going to identify the numbers, number of links required or number of teeth required whatsoever. That is called as number synthesis. And the last one is the dimensional synthesis. What should be the dimensions of different links that are employed in the mechanism, right? So now our focus will be mainly on the dimensional synthesis. So when I come to the dimensional synthesis, I assume that I know the type of mechanism and the number of links that are present in the mechanism. I should be able to only find out the required length. So that will be the focus of the kinematic synthesis that we are supposed to study. Right. So simply there, let's go through what is a type of mechanism. So it just indicates us a decision should be reached regarding the type of mechanism that needs to be employed. This will be the first phase in the kinematic synthesis. So you can choose, it can be a line work, a gear, cam, belt, anything. So different mechanisms that are available, you can just choose from the library of mechanisms that are available. So to choose that, the decision depends on the usage, where you are going to use the mechanism. Are you going to use on earth or somewhere else on the space, right? The materials that are available with you, right? So it changes from person, it depends on their own perspective, the manufacturing processes that are required, whether those facilities are available to you. So they all lie outside the field of kinematics, and it depends on the perspective of the person who designs it. Right. So further, it is impossible to solve a problem without first assuming the type of mechanism which is to be. I cannot find the number of links without knowing what the kind of a mechanism is. Is it a 4-bar? Is it a slider crank? Without knowing that, I cannot proceed further. So identifying or choosing the type of mechanisms comes as the first step or the first phase in the kinematic synthesis. And the second phase is the number synthesis. Here you are supposed to determine the number and order of the links and joints that are necessary to produce a motion of particular degree of freedom. That is very important. I cannot randomly choose the number of links. The number of links or order of joints should be such that they are going to produce a certain degree of freedom which I desire. Right. So order of the links here refers to number of nodes per link. So whether it is binary, ternary, quaternary, etc. Binary means in that joint there will be only two links. Ternary means a single joint can house three links. Quaternary joint means a single joint can host four links at a time. Right. That's the order. The value of number synthesis is to allow exhaustive determination of all possible combination of link which will yield any degree of freedom. So the Grubler criteria. So we have done that exercise previously in the module 1. So Grubler criteria is commonly used to find the degree of freedom. So once I am able to find the degree of freedom, so whether I can say whether it is a movable, is it locked, or it is constrained. So it is movable when the number of degrees of freedom is 1 or greater. So preferably most of the time we want to keep the degree of freedom as 1. So it can be greater than 1 also. If it is equal to 0, we say that it is a locked mechanism. If it is equal to 1, we say that it is constrained. So that's how we define it. So usually we wish to call it as number of degrees of freedom should be unity. So it is constrained, it is under my control. I can control the mechanisms. That's about number synthesis, where you simply determine the number and order of links and joints that are necessary to produce a desired degrees of freedom. And the third and the last phase is of the kinematic synthesis is the dimensional synthesis. Now you know the type of mechanism that you want to use, and you also know the number of links. Now you have to give dimensions to them. You are supposed to give dimensions to it. So that forms the third phase of the kinematic synthesis. It's called as dimensional synthesis. It involves determination of link lengths of a given linkage so as to fulfill the prescribed motion characteristic. So if I want to produce a certain motion, a prescribed motion, what are the link lengths that are required? So like kinematic analysis, so we can, dimensional synthesis can also be analyzed by both graphical as well as analytical method. So since module 3 is analytical, we will stick only to the analytical method. So we will not worry about graphical method as of now. The choice of the proper method is very often decided by the class. So if it is very complicated problem, definitely graphical approach will not be feasible. So now let us go more deeper into the dimensional synthesis. That is what we are supposed to explore. So when we go deeper into the dimensional synthesis, again we will encounter three classes of problems. So depending on the required kinematic characteristics that need to be satisfied, so they can be further classified as motion generation, path generation, as well as function generation, right? So each of them has their own different meaning. We will try to explore the meaning of each. So when I come to motion generation, right, I will take a simple example of a four bar mechanism. The two black things that you see here, the two they are called, here it is an input link, the black one, and the on the right hand side is the output one. So it is producing a motion, it is traveling around, or it is moving to produce a path shown as red color. So motion generation here stands for, right, they, you find a ternary link with a green color. Right, what are the different configurations that are taken up by the green color to produce the red color? That is what I am interested in. So right, you can just observe here, right? So if you come back and observe here, right, you observe that this is the mechanism and this is the path that gets generated. You can see here, this is the path gets generated, this is a red color. To generate this red, what are the different, I will call it as one, this is one configuration number one, this is configuration number two, this is configuration number three. So P1, so I will call it as P2, I will call it as P3. So if I want to traverse along this path, what are the different position that needs to be taken up by the green link? So how it takes up different configuration, so I have to study that, and that study is called as the motion generation, right? So similarly, if I have to study the path itself, right, here the path simply is the red color. Right? If I have to find out a point on a floating link, it has to be guided along a prescribed path. The prescribed path is shown in the red color. That is my path. Right? So you can simply see here, I have a point P1. It has to be guided along PJ and PN. So here that can be seen as a red color. So if I am interested in generating a path or tracing a path, that is called as path generation. And one thing that you have to remember in both the motion generation as well as the path generation is that the input and output link may not be coordinated with each other. That is not necessary at all. Right? Input and output can function on their own. Input need not be a function of output, or output need not be a function of input. In case of motion generation, I am just interested in the different configurations that are taken up by the green color to produce red color. In case of path generation, I am just interested in the path traced by the mechanism, that is the red color. So coming to the third part is called as function generation. This is quite different compared to the previous two. So in this class of problems, the motion parameters, the displacement, velocity and acceleration of the output and input links are to be coordinated. So in the previous two, they need not be coordinated. So when I come here, so I need to coordinate the input and output links. So it is often of engineering importance for me to design a four bar mechanism or any other kind of mechanism that give angular position of an output part that is a function of an input part. So let me in very simple terms, if the input rotates by 3 degrees, I want the output to rotate by 6 degrees. That is, output is nothing but input multiplied by 2, So the output is a function of input. So that is called as function generation. So that the same thing can be expressed mathematically. The motion of output and input links may be prescribed by an arbitrary function called as y is equal to f of x. So here x can be called as an input, y can be called as an output. This means if the input link moves by x, let me say it moves by 3 cm or 10 degree, the output moves by y is equal to f of x. It can be x square. If input moves by 2, output moves by x square. That is 2 square is equal to 4 degree, something like that, right? So again, so examples of certain functions that I want to generate are y is equal to sine x. Output will be sine x of the input. Something similar to that. Y is equal to 1 by x. So it will be inverse of the input. It will be square of the output y. Will be square of the input. The output y will be 1 by x square of the input. The output y will be e to the power of x of the input. The output y will be log x of the input. These are the different functions that I can generate. This is just for representation. So we will go more deeper into function generation. So in out of all the three things that are given to me, motion generation, path generation and function generation, we are supposed to study about the function generation in detail. That is a task that is given to us. So now it requires for me to correlate the rotary or sliding motion of the input and the output links. In case of a four bar mechanism, I need to correlate rotary motion of the input with the rotary motion of the output. So when I come to the slider crank mechanism, I may be required to correlate the sliding motion. The input will be a sliding motion. I need to correlate that with the output motion, which is a rotation of the crank. So something similar to that. So in case of rotary motions of the input and the output links, which you observe in a four bar mechanism, if the input link rotates through an angle theta, the output links move through an angle phi, corresponding to the value dependent on the function that is defined, right? So in case of a slider crank mechanism, output is in the form of displacement s of the slider, right? So that is the only difference between a four bar and a slider crank. So now coming to the function generation, this is what you can represent. So here you can see this is gamma j. It is a function of beta j. So you can write any function of your choice here. It can be x square or whatsoever. So I can simply say, so gamma j will be x square of beta j. If beta j rotates by 10 degree, it will rotate, the gamma j will rotate by 100 degree, because 10 square is 100. That is what you can appreciate here. So this will be considered as an input and this will be considered as an output. So input and output should be correlated to each other, or the motion of the output is dependent on the motion of the input by a function that you are going to describe in the format of y is equal to f of x, right? So this is what you are supposed to require. So here one, the black color line that you see here is called as the input link. The black color line that you see on the right hand side is called as the output link. Both should be correlated via a function, y is equal to f of x, right? So this is a summary of all the three. In the motion generation, my interest will be to, if I want to trace a particular path, what are the different configurations that are taken up by that link which is producing that motion, right? So here this is the link that producing that motion. So what are the different configurations that are taken up by it to produce this kind of a motion? So when I come to path generation, I am interested in the path that is traced by a point here. So it is a point P1. As the mechanism generates, what is the path it is going to generate? I am interested in that path only. That is called as path generation. So when I come to function generation, which is more important to me, I say that output and input will be correlated by a function y is equal to f of x. So the output behaves exactly as f of x, right? Function of the input. That is the meaning of function generation. So now you can just summarize all the three things here. So the different configurations taken up by the green color in for producing the red color is called as motion generation. So study of the red color itself, the path traced by the point on the green link to produce that red, or study of the red color itself, gives me the path generation. And the last one is a function generation, how input and output link are related to each other, right? So that is called as the function generation. Now to summarize all the things, kinematic synthesis can be classified into three: type synthesis, number synthesis and dimensional synthesis. In the type synthesis, you choose the type of mechanism that you want, right? You want, do you want a cam, do you want a gear, do you want a belt, or do you want something else, do you want a 4-bar slider? You are free to choose based on the motion requirement. In the number synthesis, you are going to determine the number of links and joints to produce a certain degree of freedom. That is number synthesis. We assume that these two are already known to me. In the dimensional synthesis, my objective will be to determine the link lengths, right? Again, that can be defined into three classifications: motion generation, path generation, and function generation. In the motion generation, I am interested in finding out the different configurations that are taken up by a link to produce a certain motion. That is called as motion generation. In the path generation, right? So to trace a particular path, right? What are the things that I need to consider? That is called as path generation. In the function generation, I should be able to correlate with the, the input link with the output link through a function y is equal to f of x. That is what the function generation is all about. So now in the kinematic synthesis, I am interested in only dimensional synthesis. I assume that type synthesis and number synthesis are already known to me. That is, type of mechanism is given to me, the number of links are given to me. I only need to find the dimension. Again, I am not interested in the motion. I am not interested in the path. I am interested only in the function generation. I know the motion, different configurations that will be taken up by the link to produce the motion, and the characteristics of the path that is generated. I only need to know input and output. How output is dependent on input via a function. Based on that, I need to find out the dimensions. So that is a task that we will be finding out. So we will take up a single 4-bar mechanism, a simple slider crank mechanism, and through function generation approach, we will be trying to find out the different dimensions of the links that are involved. So that will be the objective. So this ends the lecture 1. So in the subsequent lectures, we will find out something called as a Frankenstein equations to find out the link dimensions for a simple 4-bar as well as slider crank mechanism. So thank you.